I'm Dave Gray, and this week I learned the X-Men were never asleep.
I'm Kevin Matthews, Scottish film fan living in England, and this week I learned there is nothing that puts you more on edge than watching your internet signal get weaker and weaker while recording a podcast.
You see, we use the word edge there because we know the truth for what just happened.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The edging concluded.
It's on air. It's like a sexy Shakespeare bomb thing, isn't it? It's like, can I get it off right before the Wi-Fi signal goes out? And like half the time, yes. That's impressive, dude.
It's all fun and games until it's a cleanup on aisle 5.
Hi, I'm Craig, film fan living in England. We don't like to, though, we like to watch films in the different ways, but some of them, sometimes they're not available over here. So I had to access Kiss Me via other means, and I got it via other means. And I just wanted to check that the subs worked. And I was flicking through this film, and I cannot tell you like how many times I was trying to see if the subs worked, and I landed on wordless lesbian staring sequences. Just lesbians staring at each other, and I'm like, come on, just say fucking something, please. I need to know if these subs work. Like, why don't these people speak? Does anyone speak in that film? I was wondering. It was incredible.
I'm Tyler Hosley, and this week I learned you look so much cuter with something in your mouth. And this is Raiders of the Podcast.
Yay! Thank you. I mean, I know, but it's nice to hear.
I just thought you should know. Just me continuing my Nickelback lyric openings of the show. This week, what did I watch this week? I went to the theater, guys, and I saw a lesbian movie. Can you believe it? Are you shocked?
Madam Web?
No, I saw Madam Web, but I saw Madam Web digitally on my couch. I went to the theater and saw Love Lies Bleeding, the new A24 Southern fried romantic lesbian crime thriller. This movie is like the most me thing ever. There's mullets. There's like tons of sweat, white trash, sex, murder, Lone Star beer. There's like elements of body horror scattered throughout. It's got a wonderful score. A fucking great cast. Kristen Stewart and Katie O'Brien are fucking fantastic in this. Ed Harris rocks it. Jenna Malone. Yeah, the cast is amazing. I loved every goddamn minute of this, and I am picking it for the podcast as soon as it drops on Blu-ray because I need you guys to see it, and we can talk about it more. It's amazing.
I just like that you put the mullet before the white trash. I thought it was the other way around for you, but I learned something new.
There was no, like, order to that list, just everything.
Okay.
I keep hearing it compared to Blood Simple, which gets me really, really, really excited.
Oh yeah, it's got a Blood Simple vibe. It's kind of like Bound walked into Blood Simple, actually. Yeah,
that's like
the perfect like representation of what this is. You guys will dig, I think. And besides that, I finally started the I Know What You Did Last Summer Amazon Prime series. I'm 4 episodes in, and I'm super into it. It's like whodunit euphoria to the point that the first episode takes place at a house party, and I honestly thought I put on the wrong series. That episode, I mean, the whole series so far is all teens like doing drugs and various bad shit, and I'm here for it. And I'm looking forward to finishing that series, and that's me.
Okay, I watched Glockenluder, which is it's a directorial debut of Neil Maskell, who, you know, works a lot with Ben Wheatley, and Ben Wheatley produced this one, and it kind of makes sense because it looks and feels quite a lot like a Wheatley film. Bit of Kill List, bit of Happy New Year, Colin Burstead, which is really underrated Ben Wheatley film, which I wish had kept his original title, which was Colin, You Anus, but you know, you can't have everything. It's good. It's like a really solid debut. He kind of cleaves close to Ben Wheatley's filmmaking style, and he does borrow a fair bit, but you know, he does a really good job. It's claustrophobic. It's funny. It's really well observed. Like, he's got the knack for, you know, for family strife and just good dialogue, exchanges between the characters. It's got a really good cast. I know he works on that stupid J.K. Rowling strike program, but it's got an actor I like. He played Blue in... Christ, I really need you down the laugh because I can't remember. What was the stupid Donkey Punch? He played Blue in Donkey Punch. I can never remember his name. But he's really good. It's a solid one. The ending's a little bit disappointing, but given that its whole deal is de-glamorizing its own subject matter, it kind of could only really have like one ending. It's the only one that really makes sense. So I rated it like a 6 on Letterboxd, but after thinking on it a bit, I bumped it up to a Craig 7, which is, it's kind of like a Kevin 7, but it's better because it just is.
Hold on.
For Beekeeper. Yep.
I just want to let you know, Blue in Donkey Punch,
yes,
is played by Tom Burke. I was in my head until I started talking, and it went right the fuck away. Yeah,
I like Tom Burke.
He's in the new
stupid Rowling thing.
But... Yeah, he's in Furiosa though. So,
oh, is he? Yeah. Oh, nice. Yeah, he's really good. He's really good in that other film that you really like, Dave, Only God Forgives.
Yeah. Very good. Well, he was good in Mank. He was one of the best things in Mank because he's Orson Welles in that.
All right. That's good casting. Yeah. I still haven't seen Mank. It really didn't appeal, but I might get to it at some point.
No, you shouldn't. It's terrible. But he is good as Orson Welles.
Okay. We'll see. I might be bored enough at some point. Yeah, I watched for Beekeeper, and that was stupid. Just really, really stupid. Like, imagine, like, a million painful, really painful bee puns and references, and then Jason Statham punches people for 5 minutes, and then it's back to the bee puns, and it's just rinse, repeat, until the end, until you're either crying or drooling or both. It's boring, but it's hilarious, and it's terrible, and it's fine. I don't know. Like, Statham's good. Statham does his thing. Emmy Raver Lampman. She's from God damn it. The guy from My Chemical Romance wrote a comic. They did a Netflix series about it.
Umbrella Academy.
Yeah, she's from Umbrella Academy, which I really like her in. She's really solid in this. So's Josh Hutcherson, who I think is always pretty good. Jeremy Irons is fine. He doesn't ask anyone, like, if gay marriage will result in father-son incest unions to avoid inheritance tax. So that's good. You can shut the fuck up about that. It's tolerable, is what The Beekeeper is. And then I watched Priscilla, which I thought was really, really good. Jacob Elordi was great. It's two in a row for him. Kaylee Spaney, I'm going with Spaney, she was fantastic, and she really needed to be, because I think one of the main challenges of that film was to, you know, take a character with no real identity or agency and make her compelling, which they managed just through, you know, Spaney being given such a great performance. Cinematography's gorgeous, soundtrack's perfect, but I think the only thing that was almost on Spaney's level was the production design, which was just fucking, like, exemplary. It sells the tone so, so strongly, and it really, I think that combined with Spaney's performance, they really sell everything so beautifully. It could easily have been too slight, or I don't know, but I really enjoyed it. I know that's a favorite of Tyler, and Kevin not so much.
Yeah, didn't like it.
Yes, I was a big fan.
Team Tyler, then. I'm not sure how I feel about it, but yeah, Team Tyler.
I did like the performances. You know, it's not one to completely dismiss, but I had a I had an issue with the way it chose to show things, whether it's Coppola, you know, staying right alongside Priscilla's own version of events, or whether that is the way they sort of really want it to be.
I'm not sure if Dave's seen it. I know he's a big fan of Coppola and, you know, Nepo Babies in particular.
I haven't, because I hate all the Coppolas, so...
Oh, okay. You know. My mistake.
I mean, also, I know T's going to make us watch it eventually, so why the fuck would I force myself to? If I know it's in the future. I like fair me. Enough, I'm too pretty for that kind of self-harm.
I think that's me. No, I also watched All of Us Strangers, which I don't have any notes on, and I'll just get all confused trying to speak about it. But if it came out this year, which I think it did, it is at this point my film of the year, because it's very, very beautiful and heartbreaking. And Andrew Scott is just an absolutely phenomenal, like, empathetic, beautiful fucking actor. And I really liked I'm asking you guys a lot of questions because I'm just useless. Who was the first one to play the Queen on that stupid
role? Claire Foy.
Claire Foy. I don't usually like Claire Foy at all, but she is really, really good in All of Us Strangers. And you should all go and watch it because it's really beautiful and it made me cry like an infant.
Just to clarify, I've never watched The Crown, but I just remembered Claire Foy was like plays his mum. That's it.
Yeah, yeah. Anyone else seen that?
Yes, I loved it.
Yeah, after you gushing on it in the chat, yeah, I watched it. It's good.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, that's me. That's me for the week.
I'll apologize in advance if I do cut out. I've tried to tweak something, so hopefully I hang about. I didn't watch too much for a while I was feeding the squirrels and chasing badgers that didn't want to be chased, but then I made time for some super duper special watches. I watched Taylor Swift the Eras Tour when it dropped on Disney Plus, and I loved it. Vicky gave me the side eye for almost the entire 3.5 hours.
You guys are all judging Kevin too, yeah?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
But I mean, that's just Thursday.
Silently judging doesn't work on, on a podcast. We need to let you know.
I mean, I had enough of that. Trust me. Her glare was burning into me whenever I jokingly tried to sing along with a line. And then I got to the pictures as well. That was a bad choice. Because I decided, there was a good choice and two bad choices. I decided, let's see what all the fuss is about Madame Web. It's atrocious. And everyone else has already warned you that it's atrocious. But it's atrocious. And I really, apart from the lethal factor, preferred Morbius to this, which at least was in the same vein as the films that, you know, can't compete with the better superhero movies, but try to be a bit of fun with a more minor character. Like, Madame Web is just, it's no fun. The script is awful. Like, Johnson's quite weak in the lead role. Scott,
you don't even have to say that. It's John. She's weak in every film. That's just what she does.
In about two films.
And one of them was Suspiria, where she's supposed to be weak and awful.
Yeah. Scott now has a film to mention instead of Hellraiser Bloodline for the worst film he's been in. and annoyingly, they dance around the whole Spider-Man thing in a way that just reminds you they can't do Spider-Man.
They can do Spider-Man.
It's awful. Absolutely awful. And then, sadly, not much worse, not much better, was Drive Away Dolls, which is, like, it's unfunny. It's not quirky in a good way. It's certainly not I don't think it's a good performance from Margaret Qualley. I've been waiting for the R shoot to drop on for her for a while because, you know, seeing the acting skills of Andie MacDowell, her mother, has always been something that made me think she's surprisingly impressive for her work so far. But it's also not very good performance, not really, from Geraldine Viswanathan, if I'm pronouncing her surname anywhere close to correctly. They don't work in these roles. They don't work well together. The scripts, it's just kind of a low-key mess with stuff heaped on that, you know, the makers of the film were thinking, oh, this will be like fun. And I don't know if they've specifically mentioned it or if other people have said this is kind of in line with John Waters' movies and some other influences that they mentioned, but it's not. Because, I mean, generally, John Waters' movies are great. And the stuff that's in John Waters' movies, whether it's, subversive stuff, transgressive stuff, if it's exploring sexuality and gender, all that stuff in John Waters' movies, it never feels shoehorned in just to get a reaction or just to try and separate a film from 101 other films that would otherwise be just like it. But that's what it feels like here. Like, it's really bad. So I think Dave said this is now got to be potentially the worst thing with the Coen's name attached. I know you've not seen it yet, Dave, but replying to my reaction, didn't you say it's now bumped? What was the other bad one you had in mind?
No, that wasn't me. I don't know who said that.
All right.
No, I said that when they broke up, Joel made the Macbeth movie, which is fantastic. Ethan is threatening to make a trilogy of B lesbian road movies that are terrible. So,
right.
Yay. We know where the talent went in that family. Yeah. That's what I said.
Thankfully, there was cinematic redemption, though, in the shape of Monster, the latest film from Hirokazu Koreeda. And I really like that. I don't really want to say too much about it. I did review it on my blog, and I felt like I said a bit too much there, but it's the way you kind of discuss this film. It's just a lovely, moving, like typical Koreeda bit of wonderfulness. So I recommend that if you are fans of his work. And then two to go. Obviously, I dived in and watched Irish Wish on Netflix, because why wouldn't I?
Because it's Irish Wish on Netflix.
It's a Hallmark Christmas movie without the Christmas trimmings or like any of the Christmas cheer and all the rent-a Irish stuff in it. So it wasn't good. And it's a shame because Lindsay Lohan is still like good enough to keep me entertained with her presence, and the cast weren't bad, but it was just not good. Mothra versus Godzilla is wonderful. I really liked it. I think I would probably sit there and just watch a supercut of the twin fairies talking to other people and singing their little songs and guiding Mothra towards or away from massive events. So that's wonderful. I'm quite happy with my continuing kaiju / Godzilla / Toho journey. And I saw one more this evening, but I'll wait till Dave mentions it.
Oh, well, now I'm curious what it's going to be. I had a Craig double feature because he gushed about All of Us Strangers.
I did.
And so I went, oh, fuck that. I'm going to watch that. Fuck yeah. Because, you know, it's on Hulu, I think. It's really good. Yeah, Adam Scott is excellent. Absolutely excellent. Or Andrew Scott. I'm sorry. Jamie Bell was really good. Who was the other guy? Paul Maskell? Is that right?
Yeah.
Is good. Yeah. Claire Foy is I really like Claire Foy. It's a shame she doesn't, you know, get better jobs, because I enjoy the crap out of her. It's a good one, which made me think, oh, there was another movie Craig loved that I've been meaning to see. So I switched over to watch Give Me Pity, which I am told I am not allowed to talk about.
No, that's my next pick.
Because, yeah, so I watched Give Me Pity, and I have thoughts. And if I'd written notes, I wouldn't be able to, you know, I could skip it when I have to watch it in 2 weeks. But that's okay. I'll watch it again. I'm fine with that. I watched You'll Never Find Me, I think it's the newest Shudder original.
Which I also watched.
Nice. It's an Australian horror film that I mostly dug. The cast, it's only really two people. It's Brendan Rock and Jordan Cowan, and they are excellent. The screenplay is by co-director Indiana Bell. Co-directed it with Josiah Allen. And it's a heck of a screenplay. I mean, the dialogue is really good. The first two acts are really solid. I think it falls apart in the last 20 minutes. But I think if you want a tense little two-hander, it's not bad and it's worth checking out. What'd you think, Kevin?
Well, I want to agree with you more. I really liked the leads, and I did like a lot of the script, but the problem I had with it is it's one of those films where it's so kind of limited and tightly put together that you're already thinking two or three steps ahead. And in my mind, I think I'd already come up with some better alternatives that I thought were going to pan.
Well, I mean, I messaged you all watching it. I knew exactly what the twist was less than 20 minutes in.
Right, yeah. I mean, I had that. I saw your message, like, after, but I had a couple of riffs on that idea. And, like, even if you didn't know where it's going, you know, it's done in a way that you're thinking one or two steps ahead. Anyway, I can't deliver any real surprises, but it is good for what it does have there on screen. I'm swithering. It may be a Kevin 6 because it is well put together. I just think it's actually ultimately like pretty weak and maybe a little bit slight for the runtime. I know it's not a massively bloated runtime, but I think it's just under 100 minutes. And it might have been better at a tight, say, 85 minutes or so.
See, it's
you guys see, you disagree, and I should have read the fucking book again.
No, it's like 90, it's like 96 minutes. And no, I totally agree. I mean, I'd give it a Kevin 6 also. I was convinced you'd give it a Kevin 7. I thought you'd be like so into, because the dialogue is well structured. They handle the early suspense. I think the big problem with it is there's no buildup, because everything starts at 11, like their interactions and the tension. So there's no buildup.
I thought quite a bit of the dialogue was quite on the nose as well. Not that it's bad, and it is delivered well by the leads were great. A bit too sort of right in your face in there.
Oh yeah, and then when. Because you figure it out long before you get there, but when the movie gets there, it's tough to do that idea without being goofy, and it's goofy. But I finished off my week with the brand new 2024 remake of Roadhouse, which, it's a mixed bag. I enjoyed Gyllenhaal. I enjoyed Jessica Williams. I hated a lot of the rest of the cast. I mean, it's a mixed bag. Some of them are fine, but a lot of them just aren't and should not have been cast at all. Like, the villain is played by Billy Magnuson. And on paper, he's a pretty standard 80s villain, which should be a lot of fun. But Magnuson just can't do the part well enough. He's just crap in it. he's not cheesy enough. He's not like you needed like a, I don't know, a Busey or somebody with a presence, an ability to really chew the screen. But he doesn't have that. So instead he's just doofy. And he comes off doofy. Conor McGregor needed at least one acting lesson while on set, because he's obviously having fun, but he's bad. So fortunately he's not used all that much. Danica McKellar is the Dr. Love interest. I do give them credit for hiring a woman with a very thick Portuguese accent to play a Florida native. A Florida native whose whole storyline is dependent on her being a native of this town, but having an absolutely barely penetrable Portuguese accent. I give them props for that. I give them props for the new ending, because if they decide to do like an Incredible Hulk kind of franchise with it, I am on board. But, and the fight scenes were pretty good. But every good thing they undermine with bad casting, terrible characters, and really shit. The CG is absolutely atrocious. It is an eyesore that never should have been shown to people. Like that, it looks like a first run animatic that they just didn't replace. I mean, the CG is truly terrible. But you can do worse. It's enjoyable enough for what it is. So, yeah. This week, we watched the 2011 Swedish drama With Every Heartbeat, also known as Kiss Me, or in the original Swedish, Kiss Mig. I know, I said that way too German, and I'm sorry, Sweden. And the 1972 British comedy thriller, Pulp. Hey, Craig, would you like to pick a movie and tell us about it?
Sure, I would love to. I'm going to go with Pulp. Kevin's picked Pulp. We're supposed to do a plot here, aren't they? And let me go on to IMDb and find a synopsis, because I am really, really not sure about this one. I'm not. It's not called Plup. You know, Jesus Christ. Okay.
It's about a ghostwriter who's hired to write the life story of an actor with mob ties. When the actor is killed at his birthday party, he sets out to find out why. Yay.
Wow, that is definitely what it's about. I was really dreading this one. One of the main reasons was anytime I see the word, like the tag satire, attached to a film that was made before I was born, I just dread it. Like, I feel like I'm going to end up in this like sea of references that I don't understand, and you know, I literally have no frame of reference for. So, you know, sometimes this is fine. You watch something like Doctor Strangelove, which is, you know, it's universal, you get it, it's great. But other times you get apologies, Dave, but sometimes you get Lord Love a Duck.
And, yeah, I knew that's where you were going. I knew that's exactly where you were going.
You've got Lord Love a Duck, and you know the accompanying theme song related brain rot that you have not yet fully recovered from.
Hey, hey,
it's,
hey.
It's not good. No, please, I beg you. So yeah, I went in there, you know, a little bit of trepidation, but I enjoyed Pulp quite a lot. I'd say I appreciated it more than I enjoyed it, but yeah, it really worked for me. I think the themes are pretty universal, and I think the script is really smart and witty on just kind of a bunch of levels. Because if you want to read it as like a silly pulp noir parody, it totally works on that level. Like, you'll have fun for, you know, the runtime, but it has a kind of... there's a kind of meta element where it's speaking about a genre that is like centered on, you know, you find the person who's got the secrets, the person who's hiding some element of their identity. And in Pulp and in the life, really, everyone has secrets, and everyone is, you know, crafting this a fake identity of sorts, and the things that they're hiding are quite silly things, like little ego massaging fabrications and the harmless sexual quirks that they're repressing. None of it's big stuff, but everyone's hiding something. And the only time any real damage is done is like when they take action to hide these silly things that shouldn't matter in the first place. Like, even the narrator is lying to himself. It's a film where it's just kind of a big web of nothing. And you take all these small little moments, kind of harmless moments of repression. They inevitably breed like larger and more consequential ones. But the original, it's hard. I'm kind of struggling here. I think it's a smart film about sexual repression and, you know, identity issues and ego. And I really liked it. I really think it's got a lot to say, a lot to take in. The cast are all really good. Like, Kane is like so funny in this. He is so dry and droll, and he's got that delivery where it seems effortless, but his timing is like just 100%, like as sharp as timing gets. He is fantastic. I really, really, really liked Michael Caine. I thought he was wonderful. I thought Mickey Rooney was great. Like the shadow boxing in his underpants and, you know, him really carefully applying his rug afterwards. He plays this vain character with no vanity of his own, and he plays it really well. I mean, it's not even alluded to, but absolutely convinced. You know, it's like, you know, his Italian mama who's kind of dressed all in black and making everyone feel really uncomfortable. I kind of feel either that's he's forced his mother to dress like that, or maybe that wasn't even his mother at all. It was just like another prop for this character to sell this authentic kind of identity that he's made up. Al Lettieri and Lionel Stander, they're really great. They're like old school character actors from the like carved from granite school of character acting. I really enjoyed those, and I particularly loved Stander. That he could play, if he was still alive, of course, he could play Ben Grimm from the Fantastic Four with like no CGI or makeup. Just give him a bit, just a mild tan, and he nailed that. Script is great, like I said, like all the meta textual stuff is really, it's really clever, it's really thought provoking. It really got the wheels spinning, and there are a lot of great lines. I think the lion's share of the good dialogue goes to Kane. There are loads of lines that had me cackling. I ordered a tomato juice, then cancelled out of respect for the dead. Gilbert didn't laugh once all the way to the mortuary, and every time he changed gear, my suntan vanished. He's just got all these droll little lines that they're well written, and he absolutely nails them. What else? Yeah, I don't often give location scouts a lot of love on here, but I think the location scouts did a fucking cracking job on this film, because I think the landscape really is as much a character as anyone else. Just, you know, supposedly exotic, but really quite sleazy. Yeah, I liked it a lot. Like, there are frustrating elements, like the story meanders and the pacing is really sloppy, but that just feels to me like Hodges is like happily sacrificing entertainment points so he could stick like rigorously to the bit, which is just kind of impressive to me. Like, I really liked it. I'm not sure if this makes sense to people, but it's not as good as either of these films. But if you like the idea of, say, Robert Altman's The Long Goodbye in kind of in style of The Princess Bride in a way, that's what I came away from. And if you want something like that, you should probably find enough to enjoy here. For a film I was dreading, I had a lot of fun with this one. So cheers, Kevin.
I can only assume that Tyler broke you. And that's why you came up with that.
No.
I liked a couple things about this movie, but I was not a fan. I thought Michael Caine was good. Not like get Carter levels of good, but he's usually always pretty solid. And Mickey Rooney is fine in it too. He's giving like a pretty outlandish kind of performance here, but I think it fits the tone of the movie. Now, I did say I liked Michael Caine, but unfortunately, he's delivering some of the worst voiceover dialogue I've ever heard him speak. And this was a man that was in Jaws of Revenge and 75% of Christopher Nolan's filmography. Bless him. But some of the dialogue in this was just painful. And I usually like voiceover, but it annoyed the shit out of me in this movie. The plot is messy and convoluted, but I think it may be deliberately so because a lot of the pulp novels are exactly that, messy and convoluted. So maybe I shouldn't dock it for that. I don't know. And I guess this was supposed to be somewhat of a comedy. I didn't find very much of it humorous. It's very dry comedy and kind of sparse throughout. So if you're into that style of humor, your miles may vary there. Just it borders that line of being like an interesting misfire, but for the most part, I found it pretty boring and sloppy. Just, yeah, I wasn't on this one, guys, at all.
Yeah, I'm between Craig and T. I think there's some really solid stuff in the beginning. I think Kane's good. I think Mickey Rooney's pretty good. I agree with his takes on the two standard and I'm sorry, totally and Al Leteri. Tragically, yeah. A lot of the rest of the cast is not good. Nadia Cassini is in this, and Nadia Cassini is gorgeous and had fantastic legs and is totally, totally wasted. And the folks we spend more time with are bad, like the Bogey impersonator that was his career. That guy made a career out of it, and he's not good at it. Lisbeth Scott is absolutely atrocious. She was so bad that they actually cut the last act of this movie to get her out of it. That's how bad even Mike Hodges thought she was. Because this movie has no ending. It just stops. Which, I mean, say what you want about the pulps, they had an ending. I love pulp fiction stories. I love those kinds of noir detective stories. And as a parody of them, it's not great. It's just kind of there. And it throws away the good things at the beginning. And there are good things at the beginning. I think there's a fairly solid thing to build off of. But what they end up with is just kind of flat. And they needed to focus more. It's too meandering. It's too which way. I get what Craig's saying. I just think he's reaching a little hard to get there. Because Tyler's movie broke him. I, on the other hand, watched them in the opposite order. So I really wanted to be nice to something. And then I watched Tyler's movie and I couldn't be overtly mean to Pulp. So being fair on what's presented, I just think it's not as good as it should be. Because it's got the pieces. They just, I don't know, they don't put it together right. They don't finish put. It's like you put together an IKEA bookcase, but you only put on half the shelves and then don't understand why you got books on the floor. That's this movie. It's so close, but just watch The Long Goodbye or The Cheap Detective or Murder by Death or one of the 48 other, you know, mystery comedies that came out in 1972 to 1975. Because there were a lot.
Well, I mean, I'm pleasantly surprised that Craig enjoyed Pulp so much. I'm not surprised that Tyler didn't. I tend to be more in line with Dave. I didn't like this one as much as I hoped I would. It's been on my shelf for a while, and I just thought the ingredients were there for it to be something I would really enjoy. Mike Hodges again. With the writing and direction, Kane in the lead role being his cheeky charmer, and the rest of the cast, you know, had the potential to be all right. I think Mickey Rooney is, is an odd choice here. I don't think he's too bad in his character, but, you know, I don't think we would ever accuse Mickey Rooney of having too much range, unless we really want to include his Breakfast at Tiffany's debacle. But he's not that good here. He doesn't ever convince me in his role. So I find myself watching a film in which Mickey Rooney is getting to just muck about for a portion of the middle section. So that wasn't a lot of fun for me. Lionel Stander is fun, but he's only in, you know, a couple of scenes. So that's a shame. He feels very underused. And nobody else really stands out. So it's all down to Kane. And he can almost manage that. There are certainly moments that I found more enjoyable because it was Kane in the lead role. But I don't know, the script is more, it's almost as if it's written by people who, you know, are satisfied with their own work and think they've made something sharp and witty, but it's a bit more rambling and meandering than it should be. I don't think it's ever as sharp and witty as it thinks it is, apart from maybe the opening scene or opening couple of scenes, which I quite enjoyed with the wry voiceover from Kane. And the, I mean, it's a great opening with the reaction of people who are just in the typing pool, typing up his books because he's found that's the best way to get it done because he's a writer who doesn't really enjoy the act of writing. But I wanted something more from this and it didn't deliver. There's no, you know, I didn't appreciate the thriller mystery element. It didn't feel that important or even tense at any time. The laughs weren't really there. Again, apart from the start. I mean, I really liked the terrible taxi ride he had at the start. And just his effort to get a cab and then the bad driver he had there and the automobile disaster. But it feels now like it's from some other film. When I think back to that bit that I enjoyed, it doesn't belong in Pulp, bizarrely. So I didn't end up hating it, but it's below average. And yeah, certainly, I mean, even for Michael Caine, I think this is one of his lesser films. But we're talking in, you know, relation to his greats, not just in relation to Jaws the Revenge. Let's stay calm there. But I'm glad you liked it, Craig. I am surprised. I thought you might have all rounded on me and I absolutely hated it.
No, not for that reason.
But it was new to me, Michelle. All right. So I went from Pulp to pulpy lesbian melodrama. What?
No, I was going to say, no, we couldn't have hated it because we watched With Every Heartbeat. And then I was going to talk about With Every Heartbeat. But if you want to do it, I defer.
Oh, yeah. So I was leading into that. Yeah. It was only segue and you just went and just stepped on my segue. Thanks. Thanks.
I trampled it like a squirrel, baby. Okay, that was wrong. I'm sorry.
I mean, I brought us Michael Caine. Tyler brought us lesbians again. That's it. It is called With Every Heartbeat in some territories, which is the name of a song. In other territories, it's called Kiss Me, which is also the name of a song. Either way, this is a lesbian-centric melodrama that we knew Tyler would make us watch at some point because he's on a quest to make us watch every lesbian-centric melodrama that has ever been made. I mean, I picked the one with the best names to pronounce, so here goes. co-written and directed by Alexandra Therese Koenig, with the other writer being Josephine Tengblad. This is the tale of Mia, played by Ruth Vega Fernandez, who is about to marry, and she is meeting her. It's her dad's wife to be as well. Is that right? There's quite a mix of families at the start.
Yes.
So bear with me. Yes. I think I'm getting this right. Yeah. When she's there with her fiance meeting with her dad and her dad's wife to be, she meets Frida, played by Liv Mjøns, who is her dad's wife to be's daughter and is also a proud lesbian. And this proves quite enticing when Mia ends up forced to spend time with the new potential family members. They're thrown together for a weekend and she grows close to Frida, which will make things slightly awkward with her fiancé. That's about the best I'm going to do summing this up. Well, Tyler, are you ready?
I'm ready.
I mean, I don't know what Dave's moaning about. I really like this.
Nice. So,
I thought it was good. I thought it was, it's got obviously the woman exploring her sexuality and figuring out what path she wants to go on there. That is the main part that appealed to Tyler initially, I'm guessing. But it's also, it's got the main plot strand about, you know, families being created by the different units coming together and the extra sort of tension that brings and the moments when you are thrown together to get to know people that you've usually got no choice but to try and get on with because, you know, they are attached to someone that you love. So therefore, by default, they want you to care about them as well. So I liked that. I liked that it was going between those two main things. And then the journey of our lead character's sexual exploration is in between that. I liked the leads. I thought they were really good, both separately and together. I think Fernandez and Mjøns are just great actresses doing great work. And I don't want to spoil it. I know this is 2011, but I'm going to assume this is quite an underseen film compared to some titles that we've discussed. But I liked how things played out in the second half and the third act. And without spoiling it, there are some conversations that really move away from the lead characters themselves. Sort of people who are confronting changes in their loved ones, whether they want to be completely open and supportive or whether they think they can be completely open and supportive, but they're already speaking from a place of prejudice or subconscious guardedness or something that could be based on how they've known someone for, you know, the previous decades of their life since they were born. It could be based on just their own attitude towards every sort of different spectrum of sexuality. I thought that was really good. And then there is a moment in the third act where things come to a head, really, between two characters, a female and a male. And I think that could have played out very differently. And I like the fact that it has a moment of real tension and potential threat, but it also has this it had a realism to it and didn't need to paint anyone out to be an absolute monster or a villain just to, you know, shuffle them off screen and clear the path for, you know, what could be a central love story if these two women give in to their feelings and that's the way they're going on with their life. I liked that it didn't take that choice, and it really, really easily could have, because I thought that's where it was going, and we've seen other films where that has been the default for any man that has been on the sidelines of a relationship that has changed between two women. And yeah, it was, you know, it may not seem like much, but there are a couple of bits in this film that just in those scenes really nailed something down that I think a lot of other films that Tyler's made us watch and a lot of other films in general have either just never quite homed in on, or they've made other judgments that feel a bit more sort of stereotypically cinematic or dramatic rather than feeling as, I think, nicely grounded as this does in those moments. There's other stuff here that's very fanciful and it is very sort of movie world life, but it really made it up to me with those few moments. It just, I thought, got to the heart of a couple of different things that I didn't expect to be a part of the story. So I hope I've explained myself well enough, and I hope my internet hasn't cut out about 2 minutes ago, and that'd be nice, but that's me.
Well, okay. I'm going to agree with one thing Kevin said. There are a couple nice scenes in the second and third act of other family members talking. It's actually, there's a couple scenes between, Krister Heinrichsen as, Lasse, Mia's dad, and Lena Inder, who is a fucking powerhouse of an actress. She is amazing as Elizabeth, Frida's mom, that are really, yes, good about confronting their own biases and stuff. Excellent scenes. The problem is everything else. It's not a well-shot film. Everything looks flat and terrible. There's a couple underwater shots, like in the first 20 minutes, that are pretty nice, but the rest is bad. Here's where the movie falls apart for me is, not only are Ruth Vega Fernandez and Liv Mojans absolutely terrible in their roles, because they have no, they don't give their characters personality or emotion. They just stare at each other. I counted. See, this is a recurring problem I have with a lot of the movies, the lesbian movies Tyler brings us, and it's why I've given some more of a pass than others, is that a lot of times they fail to build the central relationship properly, and this is one. How many times do you think Mia and Frida had talked to each other? I count it. So I have an exact count. How many times? How many actual conversations do you think they have?
Half a dozen.
Six, yes. Good. Mm. Do you know what those conversations are? Talk one. Frida claims to be fucking Mia's brother and says it's a joke. That's the whole fucking conversation. Talk two. Mia learns Frida was never married. That's it. Talk three. Why did you kiss me? They're interrupted. Talk three continues. Why did you kiss me? I love Tim. It ends. That's it. Talk four. Hold on. Talk four was like an hour later. Mia finally confirming she's bisexual after everybody else wonders about it. This is an hour after talk three. That's it. Talk five. Mia asks Frida to run away with her, and this is their longest talk, and that's all they talk about. Talk six, they have a fight. They don't even have their makeup scene on camera, and this is my problem with this movie. There's no relationship between Frida and Mia besides staring at each other and fucking around, which that's fine if that's what you want the movie to be about, but that's not the movie they're selling us. They're telling us that this is something else, and that's my problem. This is a movie about two people who, like, they never deal with Frida throwing away her long-term relationship. Like, they don't ever deal with that. They don't deal with Mia's dealing with her coming into her own sexuality with her partner either. This is all just, they drop everything just for some staring at each other. And that's my problem. This is where this movie fails. This is why, what was the one with the Jehovah's Witnesses girls? I'm totally brain farting.
Me too. Totally brain hearted.
And a few others where they really, they took their, even, Blue is the Warmest Color.
You Can Live Forever.
Yes. You Can Live Forever. Yeah. Blue is the Warmest Color. A few others where they really set up the relationships. They set up the characters. They earn it. They make a good movie. This is not, this is lazy. This is a bad character piece in a character piece. Staring at each other and looking at longingly at photos online while your partner lays next to you is not, like, if it's a scene, that's fine, but it's the majority of this film. This movie is, it's almost 2 hours, isn't it? It's okay. It's 103 minutes. So it's not quite 2 hours. But, like, we are not given enough to fill that time, and instead we are left with a lot of blank, empty space, which could work, except they don't even use it to, like, fill in body language. And that's my problem with this film, where we're being told about how it's love, and but they don't ever have an actual relationship. All the actual work is being done by the other characters in their little bits, and they're not given enough screen time to carry it. If this was, like, you know, maybe a 20-minute, hour-long short, you might have had something solid, but instead, it's an hour and 43 minutes of nothing. I was bored senseless. Yeah, no, this it's a pass. Not only was it boring as hell, it's just like, staring at each other is not love. It's not a shortcut for love. It doesn't communicate what you think it's communicating. And that's my problem. Let's actually, you know, let's get some better relationships in these kinds of movies. Not just lesbian, because straight movies do this stupid shit all the time too. Let's instead of pretending like this is a good romance, let's actually make one. Put in the fucking effort. But no. Instead, it's just, it's an hour and 40 minutes of the laziest, easiest way to go about it. And it's just dull and empty. I was not a fan of this one at all.
Well, Dave, I mean, I can forgive you for not remembering the ways of the lesbian, but I think it is worth bearing in mind that after all those late nights wearing lingerie and having pillow fights, they are often too tired to have full conversations.
Yeah, see, that's my problem. That's exactly my problem. Like, even I didn't like you. Let's go back another one. I didn't like Below Her Mouth because it did the same thing, but at least Below Her Mouth stopped and let them have a scene together where they actually connected. And this never does that. And I can't stand that in any romance film. And way too often this happens. It's a pass for me, dude. It not only, it's dull. The two leads are awful, and they don't give those willing and able to do the heavy lifting nearly enough time.
Yeah, I'm with Dave here on this one. I'm sorry, T. You remember a few weeks ago when I talked about the difference between a piece of shit and a piece of crap? This is a classic piece of crap. Just kind of well-meaning, but just shallow, clumsy piece of crap. Like, to be fair, right, most of the filmmaking is fine. I think it looks fine, and the editing's fine. I think the acting is strong right the way through. I think the performers playing the betrayed partners, they're solid. The parents are excellent. They were the most interesting characters in the film, but you know, they're played by like A plus talent, especially like Lena Andre. She's fantastic. I disagree with Dave on the leads. I thought they were both like really, really good. And, you know, usually a T-lesbian joint is sort of like the law. A T-lesbian joint will have one, like, incredible, like, scorched earth performance and one that's just a bit meh. But I thought the leads were both really good here. I think they really delivered in the face of the issue, which is, like, like they said, the absolutely piss-weak screenplay. It is fucking inept. And it poisons other elements of the film, like, the visual language, for instance, like you got a character at the start inspecting like a model of a housing development before taking a like a drive in the countryside. And it's like, oh, wow, I wonder if her like carefully structured and sterile life is about to open up in wild and earthy ways. Yeah, it is, because they told us with the bad symbolism, the bad surface level symbolism. So like, it looks good, but it's in service to something bad. And like the leads, like I said, I liked them and they're trying their best. They really are. But the script is so thin on characterization and so heavy on just angsty nonsense that as much as they might try, they are not allowed a single moment of subtlety or nuance. It's not allowed. It just has to be full on fucking angst. Like that first like post-fuck dinner is overplayed to like a comical degree. They could not be any more suspicious, the fucking pair of them. And I feel like it's all on the writing and bad direction pushing the leads to give us way more than is on the page, because it's not on the page. And I'm afraid the leads, they just kind of can't do it all. Like Dave said, there's no connection here. They don't forge one on the screen. They just stare at each other. They stare at each other longingly and immediately. Like, as soon as they're in the same room, just staring. The only connection there is between them is whatever makes a woman A look away when woman B looks towards her, and then woman B look away as woman A looks towards her. So they're always in perfect time. So I guess there might be some sort of, like, spectral connection there between their necks. I don't know, but it's just I don't know. It's like Dave said, no relationship is built, and because no relationship is built, the manufactured conflicts of them both being in long-term relationships, that doesn't work either, because it just means, hey, here are your two leads, they're ruining other people's lives because they are horny. And that's all there is. There's no way they don't know each other on that level. They are just horny for each other, and they ruin lives, and it makes them fucking assholes. Like, fuck the pair of them. It was like being on a drip of like angst and movie tropes, just a slow drip, and it was exhausting. Like, there is a rush to the fucking airport in this film, Tyler. A rush to the fucking airport. And like, I should want her to arrive in time, even if it is a cheesy fucking load of bullshit. But I was praying that airport security gun her the fuck down for trying to push her way through. Gun her down, reload, you know, put another clip into her. Just end this. Just, god damn it, these people are so fucking stupid and boring. And I won't even get into the horror of this film's soundtrack. Okay, I will get into it briefly. Because there's a mystifying choice to throw a few reggae tracks into this fucking film, which was, if this was a smarter script, I'd think it was a funny dig at, like, you know, white liberals, you know, listening to reggae. But nothing else is smart like that. So it's not that. There's just some weird, random reggae in here. And the song that plays at the end, what is it, every heartbeat plays at the end, and I thought, oh fuck, this fucking song. And later I remembered, you know what, I actually like that song. I was just reacting to the end of this film, and it culminated in that song, making me for a brief time hate it. It's an awful fucking soundtrack. This is all of the worst parts of a Tyler lesbian pick. together at last, just molded together, and it kind of just sucked. I just, like I said, can we watch one of these that's like genuinely romantic or funny? Imagine one about two people who enjoy each other's company and it's funny. Like, for all the angst I was forced to endure in this, I might as well have been watching Twilight. At least, you know, Billy Burke would get a 3 cent residual check to keep the poor fucker going until his next exciting role as another fucking cop. Like, just... No. But, you know, I love you, Tyler. I just, no. Mm.
So, Kevin is my new cinema soulmate for this week.
Yeah!
I'm kidding, but Kevin, if I...
We've been building our relationship a lot longer than these fucking twats in this film. Can't do that to me.
No, I'm not going to do it to you, but...
Tyler's Kevin, my surrogate squirrel this week.
If I show up on Kevin and Vicky's doorstep tomorrow... with a van's bag full of lesbian movies and fun toys, you'll know why. I also love Twilight, but that's for another day. I mean, you guys probably know my thoughts on this movie before I even state my actual fucking thoughts, but I thought this was great. I'm a really easy mark when it comes to this particular genre of film. And it doesn't have to be lesbian. I just really love romance movies in general. Romantic dramas, preferably. Not that I don't like a good romantic comedy every once in a while, too. I just got done praising Anyone But You a couple weeks ago. That's a great movie. But I tend to fall more on the romantic drama side of things. Even though this movie does have some rom-com tropes, especially the final act. I mean, the rush to the airport cliche, as Craig said. But yeah. Like I said, I thought this was pretty great, and I adore the cast. I think the two leading ladies who played Frida and Mia are amazing. I love them. I just love these two characters, and I know I say this often when it comes to my lesbian romance movie picks here on Raiders of the Podcast, but for me, I think their chemistry is absolutely fucking great without saying very much at all. And I mean, as Dave and Craig said, they mostly just stare at each other for a good chunk of this running time, but I think that's a positive. Or maybe I've just watched too many Terrence Malick romance movies over the years where people don't say much. They just stare at each other.
That's it.
Yeah, probably it. Or maybe I just have a fetish for people staring at each other. I mean, I stare at you guys all the time, just pictures and just every day. But yeah, I never thought I'd feel so much emotion between two characters just standing there and watching deer in the woods before this film. That whole little middle section of the movie, from the deer watching in the woods to their first sex scene after swimming in that lake, was, for me personally, some of the most passionate and erotic emotion I've seen in any of the movies I've picked on here. Like, blue is the warmest color levels of raw passion, and I'm here for it. I think it's well directed. I think it's wonderfully acted. I think it explores sexuality incredibly well. And holy shit, you guys, this might be the first lesbian romance film to actually have a happy ending. They never have happy endings, but this one had a happy ending.
Did it?
I mean, yeah.
Shame they'd both become mute.
Yeah, because they stare, like, they don't even acknowledge each other.
it's happier than most of the endings that I've picked on the show, or just in general for these lesbian romance movies. They don't really have happy endings for the most part. Not saying they all don't, but most don't at all. Now, one of the main plots involves cheating, and I know people have issues with that. But again, it's a trope used in these movies often. We've seen it in Disobedience. We've seen it in Below Her Mouth. This one is actually incredibly similar to Below Her Mouth. I mean, there's tons of similarities to that movie in this, actually. A little bit lighter, but it's definitely a very similar vibe to that film. A little less graphic, but it is what it is. It's really well shot. It looks good. It feels very female because it was directed by a female, which is awesome. I think it's great stuff, and I'd easily put this at the top of all the romance movies I've picked on this podcast. Top tier, definitely.
That's insane. I'm just saying. Now I'm worried about your mental health, man.
Top five.
I'm going to write your dad, make sure he checks in on you more often, because, dude, I think you've been alone too long.
Oh, man. Maybe. Who knows?
I know I have, so it's okay.
Can I just ask? I've seen Lena Injury and other stuff, haven't I?
Oh, yeah.
I forgot to name check her, and she was great in this.
You but have.
She had a kind of familiar face.
Yeah, she's been around for forever, and if you give me a second, I'll pull... I closed the tab, and I shouldn't have. I assumed everybody had looked her up, but if you give me a second, I'll pull it up, and I will give you a nice list, because she's been in a ton of stuff. The guy that played the dad was in the Swedish Wallander series, and he's really good in that. But she... she was in the Millennium series. She's in Trelusa, which the Liv Ullmann film, which is excellent, and everybody should watch it. I had to look it up because I knew I'd say it wrong otherwise. She's in P.T. Anderson's The Master.
Oh, I've still not watched The Master yet.
Yeah, she's in a ton of stuff in multiple languages. She's in Day and Night, which is really good. She was actually in the TV series Millennium also. No, that's the Swedish show. I got confused. She's in Hustler's Diary, which is a Swedish film that was pretty solid. She's been around forever. Really good. Always happy to see. Like, she was the best part of this movie, if you ask me. But you didn't. I was just stating that as a fact. It's time to pick one. And for me, it's Pulp.
Yeah, Pulp really surprised me. I really enjoyed that one. So, yeah.
I thought I was going to surprise Tyler this week and join in with him getting the sweep, but it's not to be. But for me, it's With Every Heartbeat, a.k.a. Kiss Me.
You're insane.
It just is.
And I'm going with Cinema Soulmate Kevin, With Every Heartbeat.
Jesus.
You guys are both, like, I'm now worried about your relationship with Vicky if you thought that was an acceptable romance. Vicky girl, you need to beat him sexually again, because he's getting some weird ideas. So
I wasn't entirely sure it was an acceptable romance, but as I say, I think the bits that really pinned down impressed me that much, and with the rest around it, including the lady we've just discussed, whose name I've already forgotten in 30 seconds. Lena Millennium Lady.
Lena Indre. Yeah. So guess what? Next week is our last episode of the month of March, which means it's the special. The special this month are the films of Richard Donner. The two that were already picked were Lethal Weapon 4, which was Tyler's pick. The Omen, which is Craig's pick. I'm going to make us watch a film where you'll believe a man can fly. I'm going with the OG Superman.
Nice.
Well, I was going to go for classic Donner, and then I fancy a cheeky trip into Western territory with Maverick, but then remembered, a bit troublesome talking about Mel nowadays. So then I thought, let's just go mad. And I picked 2003's Timeline. Where people are faxed into the past.
Isn't Jim Caviezel in that? And you're telling us that Mel Gibson is a bit dodgy.
Well, I mean,
at
least Caviezel's funnier.
I can't remember if Caviezel's in it. If he is, then sure. I apologize in advance because I hate him. Paul Walker's in it, so we can get a rant from Dave.
Paul Walker's in it.
The behavior that everyone forgets Paul Walker.
He was a groomer.
I might be wrong about the weasel.
It's got Jared Butler, Billy Connolly. Yeah. It's a high Scottish contingent in that one for the Richard Donner selection. So
somebody had to hire the Scots.
Dave goes for "You'll believe a man can fly." I go for "You'll believe
a man can fax."
Faxed into the past.
Isn't Anna Farrell in that? I'm trying to.
Anna Friel.
Friel, that's it. Yeah, I'm sorry, I brain farted. Yeah. Okay. Well, that'll be something.
Yeah, you can email us at riddlesofthepodcast@gmail.com. Give us your thoughts, give us any suggestions, give us recommendations. We'll take them all on board. We've got our Facebook page where Tyler posts Wednesday pick most weeks. I did it this week and I forgot to reply already. There's a YouTube channel where I try and put a video every week unless I'm busy with badgers and squirrels. Instagram, raiders_of_the_podcast. And do remember to rate, like, subscribe to us on any podcast program of your choice and just give us all the love. Give us enough love that makes up for me saying this right until the point where Craig sighs and says, "Oh, Tyler always does it better."
No, that was fine.
That was pretty good. I mean, you remember to give the actual, you know, address to find things.
Maybe I missed you last week. Maybe that's it.
Even you saying that was fine like that is like coming off stage of a school play and your parents going, "Yeah, you were fine."
Yeah, that's why I didn't become an actor. Kindergarten play, I got to be the little engine that could. Mom just looked at me and said,
"I'd rather be passive aggressive than outright aggressive."
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's one way to be. As always, thanks for listening. Thanks for joining me, guys. We'll talk to you next week.
See ya.
Yay. Bye. In the stars, you might have changed your mind and seen your friend.